What's up, everybody? And we're back with another Top 5 Thursday. And it's another two-member edition. Is that all?
We're doing 10, 5, 10.
We're doing three videos, and we thought we had this worked out finally. Like, we were
literally
certain.
Just finished talking about it.
For the 50th time, and I still. So this is not the Top 5 Thursday video.
No.
And I've preached authenticity many a time. So we're going to leave that. Okay, so we're going to do something I was wanting to do for sure. The top 10 of this past year, which is normally hard to do, but in a way like, damn, I can only have 10 of these. This was almost like hard to do. Like, do I have 10 movies I love this year? And there was enough movies I liked, but I found myself just like, how is this even in my top 10? Any other year, this would be nowhere near it. But without further ado, guys, here is our top 10 from 2020. Want to kick it off with your number 10, Rodney? Yeah, he's got his phone on deck. He does not like
2020.
Paper. Yeah.
Paper comes from trees. Stop killing the trees.
Hashtag facts.
My number 10 for top 10 movies of 2020 is a film called Bad Education on HBO Max.
Never saw it.
Hugh Jackman, who plays Wolverine. And I forgot the other people in it, but it's a solid movie.
Was it a girl?
There was a female in it. There was
a woman.
He's basically like a teacher, but he gets caught up in a scandal that's like bad, really bad. So yeah, it's HBO Max. If you have HBO Max, check it out. Bad Education. It's a solid movie. I gave it a 6.0.
Yeah, I never watched it. I don't even know if I've heard of it. I wonder how many of those are going to be on both of our lists. I have a feeling you're going to have a lot on your list that I should have saw but didn't.
Yeah.
My number 10 is one of those movies that has no right to be on my top 10 any other year. And I actually had a little bit of a lower score from me, but a little bit. There was something about it that boosted it up. And then also I just needed a 10th fucking movie. My number 10 is Gretel and Hansel. This is a flick that wasn't that great to me, but it's one of those movies that did have me gripped till about the end. Because there isn't really anything going on, but you know how I like those slow builds. Like, it was just, the way it was shot was perfect. You have, of course, the tale of, you know, Gretel and Hansel, or Hansel and Gretel, I should say, because that's originally what it was called. They had to put that cool spin on it to make it sound cooler. And it really just waiting for what could be at the end with all that build up and the way it was shot just had me hooked in. But the thing is, it had me hooked, and then nothing felt like it ever happened. And in the end, I was disappointed in it. I really, really was. But at the end of the day, I will say it at least kept me gripped. And when I think back on it, I'm like, it was really well shot, and it had me on the edge of my seat, even if I never got to where I wanted to be. It at least had that going for me. When I think back on it, I'm in no rush to watch it. I wouldn't tell you to rush and watch it, but it's barely, just barely a good movie, and I'm going to watch it again to see if I missed anything.
I still haven't seen it yet. I still need to watch that movie.
Yeah, it just, dude, I'm telling you, it's beautifully shot. It's like any other movie like that you're just like, okay, this just feels professionally made. There's a lot of time and effort crafted into this. And there's that buildup, and you know the story. You know, everybody's heard the story of, you know, Hansel and Gretel. So you're just waiting for that to happen, and it just falls flat at the end, unfortunately. But
that sucks.
But it got just enough of, you know, the right ingredients, even if it kind of failed at the end, for me to give it a barely passing grade and for it to make a list that it would normally not ever make. Number 10, Hansel. I can't do it. They had to fuck with the name. Number 10, Gretel and Hansel.
What was your score?
That Hansel's so hot right now. I think I said it. Maybe I didn't. 6.3 out of 10. Yeah, I want to give it a 6 down the line, but, dude, the cinematography, I was all over.
Yeah, that's what attracted me about the trailer of it, mm-hmm. was the cinematography. I still need to watch it.
Yeah, so. Worth the watch. At least once.
All right, so my number 9.
Yes, sir.
for movies of 2020. This one's kind of weird for me because I loved it, didn't like it, to loving it, to now it's like, you know, it's a solid, you know, great movie to watch, but not like astounding.
Man, you have my curiosity, now you have my attention.
My number nine is Tenet. Christopher Nolan's Tenet.
Oh, I got a story about that movie. That, kind of.
The first time I watched it, the first time I watched it was in IMAX, and it was, you know, the first time I'd been back to theaters since the quarantine. Mm-hmm. So that excitement of being back in the theaters again, you know, had me all hyped up about it. And I thought I watched a flawless movie. And then I went back to see it a second time in IMAX, and, you know, it was completely understandable too the second time. First time I was like lost, didn't really understand what was happening. Mm-hmm. But then the second go around, everything was good. But then I watched it a third time and it's just like, I don't know, it's good
again?
No, like I understand it, but it's like
I'm still like, you need to break down some shit for me, because even though I haven't seen it a second time, I was pausing it. Like, you didn't have the liberty to do what I was doing. I was literally pausing it and I'm like, all right, if that makes sense, then this. And I'm like, finally, like 30 minutes later, I'm like, maybe I can justify that. Hopefully there's nothing else like this so I don't have any more situations like this. Fucking press play, another wave of shit that makes no sense hits me. And I'm like, dog. Like, and I'm tying everything together the best I can. I'm like, dude, I honestly feel like none of this makes sense. Like, it makes sense at like a base level. Like, you know, like, okay, he goes backwards here, he goes forwards here, but it just fucking like that kid that dumps out his pile of toys and you're like, oh god, not again. That's what it feels like. Like, they just dump it over your base knowledge, and then when you really pause it and sit down, you're like, all right, if that's here, but then how is he here, and if how is this here, it doesn't add up to me.
Yeah, it's definitely confusing the first time you watch it.
Yeah, I don't see it ever changing for
well,
me.
No, you watch it a second time, you might understand
like
it better.
Like I said,
especially
the pausing.
Since you know what's coming each scene now, like, you'll watch it the second time and be like, okay, now that I know this is about to happen, I can connect this and this. It does help. But overall, it's a Christopher Nolan film. You know, he really can't make a bad movie. Yeah. So it's like I'm going to leave it at a solid 9. I gave it a 6.5.
Yeah, I got to say, I actually gave this one a negative grade. And through the first, like, hour or so of the movie, I was hooked. I was like, this has potential to be my favorite of the year. And then it's like he just Nolanized it.
Yeah.
And it was, like, too much. I feel like he tried to make his masterpiece, so he, like, tried to go too far in one direction.
Well, the sound mixing in it was it's awful.
I don't know
what's
going with that.
I'll say the sound mixing was bad.
Yeah, but Tenet, pretty good. What'd you rate it?
6.5. Really? 6.5 for Tenet, my number 9.
That's actually lower than I thought you'd give it. My number 9, I'll just go ahead and say it, is also a 6.5, and that is Underwater. Yes, Underwater. This is another one I was a little underwhelmed by. I was hoping it'd be a little bit better with everything I heard and, you know, heard about it and saw in the trailer, you know, amongst the horror community. And it's not a bad flick by any means. It's on a top 10 list, even though I just proved that that's kind of easier to get into if Gretel and Hansel. But it's just, you know, it's okay. It's good, but it's almost closer to okay. Even talking about it, I'm like, I need to watch it again. Like, is 6.5 even worth it? Or maybe I missed something. But I watched this one at the beginning because it came out in, like, January, I think, of 2020. So this has almost been, like, a year since I've seen this movie. So this one isn't as, like, on my mind where I can explain why I didn't like it. I think it was more the monsters kind of felt more CG-ish and, like, I don't know. It's felt like it's not that it wasn't well shot. There's something about it felt more fake to me. Like they could have pulled, like, they had an opportunity to pull off something and do it a certain way, and it just wasn't the way I wanted it. But overall, there was some decent tension at times in there. I liked a couple of the characters. I thought T.J. Miller was good in it. I thought, you know, Kristen Stewart was amazing, very underrated actress, and she's one of those chicks that can pull off the short hair look. Not many can. Like, she looks dope in the movie. So, she, you know, she's nice to look at as she carries you through it. And overall, like, I just really liked her character in the movie. But in general, though, it wasn't enough for me. But in a bad year, it's just good enough to squeak into my list. Like I said, 6.5 for Underwater.
That's my worry, but I haven't seen that one either because my worry was the monster in it. If I feel, I felt like it was going to be a build-up. I don't want to.
Well, no, the final like monster looks really cool. Like he's really big, but there's a lot of like little monsters before that.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that are just like. I mean, they're not like tiny. Like the other one's huge, and these monsters are about like human size, and they're just popping in and out. And I had a lot of more qualms with it, but I honestly, it's been so long since I've seen it. It's been like a year now. I can't remember every little thing, but yeah, 6.5.
Oh, yeah. So, my number 8.
Have I seen this? So far, we haven't seen any of the movies on our list. Yeah. Like, well, I
feel like you have.
Well, it's yeah, no, I saw Tenet. That's right. I forgot. Oh, yeah, you did your 9 already.
So, my number 8, it matches Tenet's score. I'm going to go on and say that is a 6.5. But, my number 8 goes to The Old Guard on Netflix, the Charlize Theron movie.
I didn't watch it.
It's actually,
I remember you telling me about
it's actually
it.
Pretty good.
Yeah, I forgot it, really it existed, is. But you told me about it.
I went in with low expectations and came out rather happy with it, honestly. I mean, the story, the arc of it was actually really, you know, pretty decently done.
Mm-hmm.
And they left an opening kind of to where there could be more, you know, movies mm-hmm. afterwards. But, I mean, the action was solid. Charlize Theron, of course, she's always great. She yeah. can't do no wrong, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, my number 8, she's The Old Guard on Netflix.
The Old 6.5. Guard. I forgot about that one. That was earlier in the year, wasn't it?
Probably around like, no.
It feels like months upon months
no,
ago.
No, I think it was like August or July.
Okay, well, even then, dude, that's fucking like 4 months ago, 5 months ago.
Yeah, almost. It's May now, so.
Dude, what? When did we record this? What?
2 months ago.
Yeah, it could have been 5 months ago, for all I know. All right, my number 8 is one I just watched recently for Christmas. I know, I think you said you weren't a fan of this one, is Christmas Chronicles Part 2.
I was disappointed.
See, I wasn't. To me, this was just like the first one. It's just kind of harmless fun. It wasn't great, but now we're moving into the 7 range. I gave this one a 7.1. It's just, you know, there's nothing really, like, amazing to say about this other than, man, it's Kurt Russell in a Santa Claus suit. It was cool to see Goldie Hawn because it's been a while since I've seen the first one, but I believe she was only kind of, like, at the end. It's kind of cool to see her, like, fully in the movie. And I'm a huge fan of just, like, world building, man. When you can turn something out of nothing into something and creating it and just seeing like what the hell I forgot what they called it, like the whole where, I mean it's in the fucking North Pole obviously, but whatever they created, that little town with the fucking the elves and shit. I thought the elves were kind of funny and, you know, cute or whatever. And, you know, I watched it with the kid and the wife. Everybody seemed to enjoy it. And, you know, the fat kid or whatever from Daredevil, he was okay. I don't know. I think he's just got one of those faces that annoys me, but his character and the way he acted out was really good. And, you know, not great. Probably wouldn't make my top 10 any other year, but Christmas Chronicles Part 2 had to be my number 8 at a 7.1.
I couldn't find it.
I
was looking up the name of the
town. Oh, I'm not that worried.
He was the weakest part of that movie to me.
The fat kid?
Yes. And I didn't. Such big shoes to fill, though. First Christmas Chronicles is amazing. It's in my top 5
Christmas movies.
Yes,
it was solid. It came out of nowhere, but this one did about the same for me. It was just, it was good.
So,
Christmassy movie. Yeah.
My number 10, 9, 8, 7.
Yeah.
My number 7 is
7.
Okay, if y'all recall from way back when we did the Bad Boys movies, y'all remember that? I'm pretty sure, and I need to go back and look, but I'm pretty sure I gave Bad Boys for Life like a 9.5. All right, and that's because I was so impressed with the movie being good after, what was it, 15 years after Bad Boys 2?
I want to say, Bad Boys 2 came out in like 03, I think.
Okay, yeah, so.
That'd be 17 years. If that's correct. It's somewhere in that range, if I'm wrong.
Number 7 is Bad Boys for Life, by the way.
I thought you said that already.
But but no, it's like
you went into detail about the other Bad Boys movies. Like, what the fuck?
It's really good. It really is. Like, the chemistry is still there, beautifully there, between Martin Lawrence and Will Smith. So everything was great about it. It's just now that time is, you know, passed, and I've watched it recently again.
Got you rethinking
like,
it.
Yeah, it's still, you know, a good score, but I don't give it that I did. It's a 7.0 for me. Bad Boys for Life.
Jesus.
Yeah.
What a fucking drop.
It's still a good, and that's still a good score. Because, I mean...
It is, but compared to what you had...
But what I had, I was just so excited. And I was excited, you know, talking about Bad Boys too.
And now
so.
I feel like you're overthinking it. Like, you probably like it more than that. You're just like...
Now that I've thought about all the horrible things.
Yeah. Number 7 for me is going to have to be Possessor. And this is like a horror sci-fi flick. Yes. But I believe... David Cronenberg's son, Brandon Cronenberg. And this movie, it's another one. Like, it's got great potential, and the story is unique. It's different. I always love when they do that. And they combine horror with sci-fi. It's normally a huge winner for me. Not saying this one wasn't. I like the lead guy or whatever. And the characters in general, they weren't, you know, like, very fleshed out necessarily to me, but they were just... You know, they weren't stock characters either. They were solid enough. And overall, the movie just felt solid enough. I liked what it was going for. I liked what it tried to do. But for me, it just felt a little short of great. Like, when I got done watching it, it felt like one of those movies immediately where it felt like it kind of missed the mark somewhere, but I couldn't really pinpoint where. And it also kind of felt like one of those movies I'm like, if I pop this in again, I bet like I'd enjoy it a lot more. So this is the type of one that has potential to move up on this list. But at least for a first-time watch, which was pretty recently actually, I got to put Possessor at 7 with a 7.2.
I still need to see that too.
Yeah, so we just haven't seen any of our own movies.
Okay, so that takes us to number 6. And my number 6 is a Pixar film. And that Pixar film is Onward. I liked Onward a lot. Not the best Pixar movie, but a really solid, really heartfelt movie. You know, and then you got Tom Holland and Chris Pratt, you know, teaming back up again, playing brothers in the film. But, yeah, if you all haven't seen Onward and your kids haven't seen it, watch it with them. It's a solid movie.
I haven't seen Onward. We haven't seen any of our lists.
I gave like Onward.
We've got each like one movie. You got Christmas Chronicles on mine. I have Tenet on yours, I think.
Yeah, but you got Bad Boys for Life.
Yeah, that's right. I forgot. I did see that. That's 100% true. Seems like that.
So yeah, I gave Onward a 7.0.
Nice.
And I was pretty happy with it. So.
Hell yeah. My number 6 is Train to Busan Presents Peninsula. This is one I heard get shit on nonstop. And I don't really want to go too deep into this. And I almost don't even want to go into my rating because there is something that tells me we might review this soon. Take that, you know, with you in whatever way you will. I have to at least, I think, give my rating on this. Maybe I don't. I guess I don't. I'm not going to give my rating on this one. They're going to be able to fucking piece it together. So, like, so it's in between this and then it's this because they'll know that the one after this has to have a higher rating. So, yeah, I guess I got to give my fucking rating. Train to Busan Peninsula. I'll give it a 7.5. I'll just say not as bad as people say, not as great as I wanted it to be either, but still a solid zombie flick. And that's about as deep as I'll go into that one because of future things.
I also need to watch it.
Yeah, soon. Maybe. Yeah. I've Maybe, never
get
seen
on
that.
There.
Yeah.
Which leads us to, drum roll, top 5. You're too late.
Sounds like I'm jerking off.
So here we go.
Dude,
okay.
It always happens. I'm sorry, dude.
Our top 5 Dirty movies Nine. Of 2020.
It's crazy.
My number 5 is King of Staten Island.
Dude, I didn't watch this one. It's like, If we combine our lists together, dude, we might have a hell of a top 10. We just don't watch the right movies. Or
so, Pete Davidson surprised me with Big Time Adolescence, and then he comes out with Judd Apatow as a director coming out with King of Staten Island, which is basically a what if, like if Pete Davidson hadn't gotten into comedy and he just focused on being a tattoo artist, pretty much. Mm-hmm. This is a really good movie.
It looked really good.
It's got,
and Bill Burr's in it. Like, and he's acting a little more serious. Bill in this
Burr
one.
Is so good in this.
That's what I was he's saying. So good it looked like he was. I love some Bill Burr, so that immediately interested me.
But it's definitely a must see. I give it a 7.5 easily. I mean, it probably could go higher, but I have to watch it more than once. So yeah. I need to rewatch it again and get like a for sure, you know, thing. But I mean, for my first time watch, being a 7.5, Pete Davidson, y'all be on the lookout for him. I'm telling you, he's good. So
100%. For me, my number five is going to have to be The Hunt. And this is one I actually waited on watching for the longest time because I've seen this kind of movie, I feel like, a million times. And I feel like I can guarantee what it's going to be. And that is, I'm going to like it for sure, but I'm not going to love it, and I'm not going to like it that much. It's just kind of going to be a one-off watch, like, that was cool. And something about that, when it came out and I was going to go buy it, I kept passing over it because there's no mystery to it. Like, I'm like, I know what this movie is. I just do. I have a great grasp on what I'm going to like and what I don't. It's almost like uncanny. That's why I like buy all my movies before I watch them. And this one basically did that, but was a little bit better than I expected. It isn't quite great, but it's borderline great because it's good in the terms of not taking itself too seriously, which we saw in the trailer. And the main girl, dude, she just knocks it out of the fucking park. Like, probably one of my favorite characters out of any of these movies or any movie from the year. She just fucking nailed it. Like, she's badass in all the right ways. She's like, she's not really like that hot chick that's a badass, but she's kind of like unconventionally hot, which is cool because it's not, it's almost like you can tell they weren't going for like hot chick kicks ass type situation. But It's just good, dude. And I like all the fucking cameos and characters and the fact they weren't afraid to just kill a motherfucker off right away. And Hilary Swank was really good in it, too. And I got to give The Hunt a 7.5. We'll get to the great movies eventually.
That's a very divisive one, too.
Yeah.
Like, I haven't seen it, of course, yet. But,
yeah. But in the end, it still wasn't quite enough to be great. So it was exactly what I thought it was. Again, it was just a little higher up on the scale of that. I thought it was going to be more like 6 to 7 range, but it almost made it to great.
Well, I'm going to need to check it out.
Yeah, on the strength of that lead chick, dude. She nailed it. Nailed it.
My number 4 is a Pixar movie.
Again?
Soul.
Your picks are...
Now,
terrible.
I'm not gonna go into too much detail. I know a lot of people have seen it, but it just dropped on Disney Plus. Soul did, and it's Pixar's newest movie. Mm-hmm. And
everybody's been talking about that in the group. It's
really good. Soul is really, it's really deep too.
It's got some soul to it.
That, yeah,
for sure.
It's a little bit,
maybe.
No, it's a. It's really it. I don't know how to explain like the meaning of this movie. Like, yeah, I'm not gonna give away anything. Actually, just if you haven't seen Soul, watch Soul. It's really good. It'll make you question some things, like even as an adult. Nothing bad, of course, but yeah, dude, check out Soul. Really good. I gave it a solid 8.0.
All right, my number 4 is The Invisible Man.
Haven't seen it.
You
really? I'm waiting on my dad.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah. People were like, oh, my God, this movie is brain melting. It's so great. Dial it back, bitch. This movie, I mean, it's my number 4. Even if it's a shitty year for movies, it's still in my top 10. That's saying something. But I don't know, man. It's one of those movies, a movie I related to. actually, I'm going to have to bring that movie up in another video we do very soon. So I'm not even going to bring that up. But it basically is one of those movies that feels like it should be great. It feels like it is great at times. But there's just, there's something missing. Like, there's too many, like, dry spots in it. And there's, it's like there's amazing, great moments that are in great movies. But everything in between those is, like, feels real flat and empty to me. And then also some of the moments that you're like, should have been great. Like, say they set up, like, 10 great moments. They have three of them that nail it. Like, they just fucking, like, oh, my God. They just fucking ran away with that right there. But then they have seven other ones where you're like, you can tell they tried to nail it. And it's like, this just doesn't work. Like, you could have improved on that. Why didn't you do that like this? Ooh, if you did that, would have did that like this. And then kind of had it shot this way. That'll work so much better. Like, there's just so many moments like that where it left me like, ah, almost. And in the end, it's a movie I feel like should get a great score. But it's just not quite there. I give it a 7.6. But solid movie. Don't get me wrong. Go see Invisible Man if you somehow still haven't. And go buy the shit. Own it. It's a good fucking flick. But I think people need to dial back on the great talk. But, I mean, if you want to see Wynell's amazing movie, watch Upgrade.
Upgrade is so good.
This is a great movie, too. Or not great. I just said it wasn't great. It's a really good movie, too. But it's no Upgrade or anything like that. It's definitely not an upgrade over Upgrade. Just put it that way.
Yeah,
but it's solid. Watch it.
Top three.
Oh, shit.
2020.
Well, I have a great movie this year. I still haven't had one. Your number four was great, wasn't it?
Yeah, mine's no. Number four is eight.
So you've moved into the great version.
Yes.
Great place.
My number three was my favorite movie of the year for a while.
Haven't seen it.
You might. Well, I remember telling you about it when I watched it. My number three goes to Andy Samberg in Palm Springs.
That's
on
right.
Hulu.
Yeah, I didn't watch it because I never listened to you. Yeah. So I knew immediately when you said no. Yeah, I want. Yeah. That's one I want to see. I love Lonely Island. I love Andy Samberg.
Yes.
Just haven't got around to it.
And Palm Springs is beautiful. Okay, so Palm Springs, it's a time
loop. It is.
He's stuck in an endless time loop, and they have, why am I freezing on her name right now?
Yeah, I don't have it. They have a girl.
She's a comedian. So, yeah, so she ends up getting stuck in this time loop with him, and they got to figure out a way out of this time loop. Mm-hmm. This movie is so funny, but also has so much heart.
That's what you're saying. I dig that.
It's really like the way their character arcs built and everything throughout the movie, and the romance in the movie even, like, it's everything was just really well done. And for Andy Samberg, it's like, I thought it was going to be a funny, goofy, you know, whatever movie, but it ended up surprising the shit out of me.
A little bit of both.
So, yeah, Palm Springs is my number three for sure. Gave it an 8.0 also.
Nice. My number three, I'll be damned, this is on both of our lists. And you're like, well, he's only seen like two movies from his list, and he said he didn't like Tenet. That's right, bitches, Bad Boys 3. The last movie I saw in theaters, I've still not been back. Saw that shit opening night, I believe. Just so hyped for this. Love the first two Bad Boys movies. And a lot of it, I think, you summed it up perfectly. The fact that they did get it right was so surprising. I was like on cloud nine when I left the place, but now I'm on cloud eight because it's an 8.6. Yeah, I did have it in the nine range as well initially. But, I mean, it is good, dude. It's about, I can't imagine them doing this any fucking better. You're looking at a movie that had probably the best villains of the whole fucking franchise. It was amazing, the villains they had. You had the twist within the movie. The jokes were nailing. The action was great. I don't want to give away too much if you still haven't seen it. But, I mean, it just checked every box and added a few new ones on top of that. And by the end of it, the franchise felt more alive than it ever had been before. And if you would have told me all that plus that was going to be a thing, I'd have been like, you're fucking crazy. Well, you're not. You're not. Bad Boys 3 is a motherfucking 8.6.
8.6.
I like it. I like it a lot. I love it, in fact. There's my first movie that I love of the year.
In Love?
more of a side bitch that you really care about.
Gotcha. Well, on to my number two. Guy Ritchie film. The Gentleman.
I didn't watch it. I heard it was great.
You still haven't watched that?
Dude, I'm saying the same to you with all these movies on my list. True. I'm just like, damn, son. You missed a good one there.
Yeah.
Like, our whole list is like, well, just say some shit I ain't seen.
on both sides. We have a lot of movies we need to watch.
That's what it sounds like. This is like a throwback kind of year. I just chalked it up to a loss and just didn't watch. Even the ones that were coming out, like, I wasn't even renting them. I wasn't doing anything. I was like, I'm just going to have a full-on throwback year. I'm throwing this year away, and I'm going to dive into all the movies I should have seen back in the day. I'm going to buy all older movies like Scream Factory releases like I did before, but now I'm going to grow my collection exponentially because I won't have to buy newer movies, and I just went all in with that. So I feel like not only did we get a lackluster amount of like great blockbuster movies, a lot of them got pushed back, I also mentally was not trying to seek out new movies. So inevitably, I have a shit top 10.
Some good new movies.
There is. Hey, I'm telling you too here, man. There's some good ones out there you're missing.
But yeah, The Gentleman. It's a Guy Ritchie film. If y'all are fans of Guy Ritchie movies, this will not disappoint you at all. Matthew McConaughey, Hugh Grant is in it.
Hugh Grant.
Charlie Hunnam from
Hugh Grant.
Yeah.
When's the last thing Hugh Grant's been in? Am I that asleep on his career? I feel like I haven't
about
heard.
About a boy.
That's what I'm saying. That's the last thing I remember.
That's what I remember last.
I legit though. I'm like, is Hugh Grant alive? Yeah. Like, I forgot he even existed.
Oh, he's alive and well, and he kills it in this movie.
Does he? That's awesome. He does Hugh Grant great. Was solid back in the day. Yeah, dude. Everything I saw him in, like, I feel like he's
what
got.
What was it? Bridget Jones' Diary.
Yeah, he's got a lot of like low key roles that you're like, oh yeah, I did love that. Mickey Blue Eyes.
Yeah,
I used to love that movie.
Dude, Hugh Grant. Yeah, he's like, what's his name?
You're blowing my mind right now. I'm like, Hugh Grant.
Yeah.
That's right. I have a lot of movies to go back and watch. And by that, I mean like two. About a Boy and Mickey Blue Eyes. But
dude, it's been so long. I used to watch About a Boy on repeat,
dude,
when I was younger.
Saying, what the fuck, dude?
So,
Hugh
yeah.
Grant. Now I'm watching it. I got to see my boy Hugh.
The Gentleman. Great movie. 8.5
dude,
from me.
That's insane. I've heard some great things. I do dig the cast. I just never got around to it for whatever reason. My number two. I have a feeling this may be coming up for you. If it isn't in your top 10, I would be very confused. So I know. I didn't know. I didn't look at it, but we'll see. We'll see
Cheater.
If he surprises us. My number two is The Way Back, and I'm giving that a 9.1 out of 10 because The Way Back was so surprising. And as soon as I saw the trailer, I immediately was like, this is going to be the sleeper hit of the year. You could just feel it. It just felt like Affleck's time. He was coming off that bullshit with Batman. He had all these things going on. I'm like, it's time for him to have a spiritual journey and film. And I was like, if this is played like I hope it is, which, like I said, I get vibes off movies, I was like, I bet the basketball shit won't even be that important. Not important might be the wrong way of putting it because it feels essential within the movie, but it's something in the end just to give the main star something to do and let him work out essentially what you could maybe even consider a passion project because it reflects a lot of his real life struggles. And anytime you tell me an actor is about to channel that and put it into a real movie, I'm seeing it and I'm hyped for it. And usually because it is real life, it's not even like acting for them, they knock it out of the fucking park. I mean, look at fucking Eminem and 8 Mile, dude. That motherfucker killed it. You think Eminem should be in dramas? Probably not, bro. Batfleck murdered this one. The Way Back is still going under the radar, and you've lost your minds. Go watch The fucking Way Back. It is a great movie, and my first of two nines of the year. Low nine, but still a nine. 9.1 for me.
Still haven't seen it.
That's right, yeah.
You need to check it out.
Yeah.
Number one, movies, favorite, top 2020 for me.
It is...
My number one is a movie called The Way Back.
I knew you didn't want to say it, did you?
With Ben Affleck. Really, it's a movie about, you know, he's an alcoholic and he coaches a team for basketball players and their kids, but he actually has some drama in his life with an ex, and I'm not going to go into detail about that, but no, but for real though, like the movie, it's a really deep movie, and I'm not going to sit here and say it's a, you know, rainbows and roses with this movie, because it's not. And it's the way, what is his name? The director of this film.
I don't know. I really don't remember who directed it.
Gavin O'Connor did this?
Maybe. I don't keep up with directors like that, surprisingly. I mean, I do and I don't. I shouldn't say don't.
I think it was.
I'm not like oblivious to it, but there's also times you might think I should know an obvious director and I will be oblivious to it. And you'd be like, Brandon, really, man?
Really? Okay, yeah, it was Gavin O'Connor.
Okay, that sounded right.
So, and he's done a few other, yeah, like that Warrior movie, the MMA movie.
Oh, I love it.
Okay, so another movie that also deals with addiction, but it deals with sports, with the MMA, but it doesn't solely invest the heart of the film in sports. Like, it's more about the family and what they've been through together, and that's what the way back is like, you know. It's like it really dives deep into his problems and who he is, who he used to be, who he is, and who he's going to become.
Yeah, he's good about that, dude. Yes. In those movies, because that's really what it is. It's like, you don't want to say it's insignificant or like it's just kind of like a crutch in the movie. It's more of like, it's not flat out this, because they do such a good job of executing it as well. But it's almost like a side plot to the movie in a weird way.
Sports.
Yeah. Yes. It's that part of the movie is to give the lead actor, or like actors, if you're talking about Warrior, something to do. They need something to do in the movie. And what drapes over that is the real story, what's going on, the inner struggles of these people. And, you know, they can bring out their inner struggles and come out on the other side of it via what they've been given to do, which is these sports. And it's not just wrote off either, which is what makes it special. It's like, let's just give them something to do, and that'll kind of be that, and then we'll focus on the struggle. They do a good bit of making sure that is highlighted and stands out too, to where you are invested in it. But at the end of the day, you still know what the most critical part of the movie is and the message is, and that's behind the sports. It's what layers over the sports. And he does such a good job of balancing that, if that is the same director. Because I can definitely see the parallels now in both of those.
Yeah, he's done well. Not to get too off track, but Coach Carter.
Yeah.
Directed Coach Carter. Hoosiers.
I'm not a huge Coach Carter fan.
Glory Road. Right.
He really does only he do got sports. Games that does he only do games? Sports
You
movies?
Know, now that you say, I felt like he had done
Is
more.
There anything else?
I know he did X-Men, one of the X-Men movies, I'm pretty
that's
sure.
That's insane, dude. I've never even realized it.
You know, now that I'm reading the list, like, because that's all that was popping
He's
up.
He's literally like,
sports movies.
Whoever, who wants to come over and do some sports?
Yeah.
That's literally it.
And those are all solid movies.
Yeah, not bad.
That aren't solely focused on the sports.
You know, Coach Carter, I'm not a huge fan of it. I don't hate it. I don't really love it either. It's just kind of man in me. But I think about all the good basketball movies there are, and it's still, there's not that many. It's usually like football movies that steal the show with how good they are from sports movies. So, I mean, even when saying that, Coach Carter is still one of the better basketball movies I can think of.
I like Coach Carter.
Solid enough.
You got Bride and Glory, Miracle.
Miracle. My God, dude.
The Accountant.
Where's that's the whip? There you go. Yeah. He's like, damn it, Affleck, get over here.
Okay, so yeah, The Way Back is an 8.5 for me as well.
No, well, yeah, well, it was a 9.1 for me.
I'm saying
yeah, but you say as 8.5 well, it sounds
because
like,
number two of mine was 8.5.
Oh, now I got you. Yeah. Hey, my number one is what you're not going to agree with, and I guess I'm going to have to spoil another rating. I'm just going to come out and say it. I don't give a shit anymore. If you watched it, you got a sneak peek. The Rental. We are literally going to drop. Yeah, don't even fucking do that. This review next week, so be ready for that. But I guess I'm going to have to talk to you a little bit about it, not much. It is a 9.2 out of 10. This is one of those horror movies that comes around. Seems like I get like one a year, one every other year, that just, boom, like shakes me up, dude. Like, I'm like, this is fucking amazing. It's a slow burn, so be ready for that. And, you know, just hang on for the ride, because the end is going to get fucking crazy. I won't go into it too much because I'm about to dive deep into it here on Friday, so be ready. Well, when will this come out? Okay. I'm trying to think. I'm like, I'm over here talking about it. We release our videos. I'm like, wait, does this come out before the rental? I'm over here live.
This comes out Sunday morning.
No, it doesn't. Yeah. Either way, Rental Man, amazing. 9.2. All right, Rodney. Jesus. Fucking hater, dude. Fucking hater.
You believe that?
Rental. So that was our top 10 movies of the year 2020, which has been a really shittily awful year.
Shittily.
So 2021 will be better, hopefully.
Hopefully. Some say. Hopefully. Look at me like, do I turn it off?
All right.